Our next speaker is David Zueco from University of Zaragoza, and he's going to talk about suppression of superradiance by magnetic correlations.
Okay, good afternoon to everybody. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers to give me the opportunity here to tell you our work done in Zaragoza, in Spain, about using magnetic molecules as qubits. So this is the outline of my talk. In the first part, I will tell you about our progress on testing if it is possible to replace superconducting qubits by simple molecules, by magnetic molecules that will be coupled to a superconducting resonator via the magnetic field. This is really challenging for us, and I will tell you only the progress. And in the meantime, before reaching this single molecule limit, if we can do some interesting physics with not only one molecule, but with magnetic materials or with ensembles of molecules coupled to superconducting resonators. So our idea is to, instead of using circuit QED, what we call magnetic QED, so essentially our idea is to put molecules on top of superconducting resonators. In the superconducting resonator, it will be quantum fluctuations measured by the magnetic field. And this magnetic field will couple to the spins of these magnetic molecules. These magnetic molecules have some spins. So essentially, these nanomagnets are going to play the role of qubits, and the coupling is going to be via Siemann, via magnetic dipole to the molecules. And also via an external magnetic field in a magnet with a vector magnet, we can control the splitting and many other things of the molecules. So the idea is to generate this James Cumming or quantum Rabi model with magnetic molecules. Especially what we want is to have a sufficiently strong coupling, at least stronger than the losses appearing in the molecule mainly. So if we want to work with molecules, we need to go to the chemistry people, and there is a lot of molecules. So there's one advantage is that there are so many molecules and there are so many people working on this that there is an improvement of the T2 times. As you can see this in this paper, we collect the results since updated 2 years ago, and then there are some molecules with a spin 1/2 that are already reach the microsecond T2 times. And if this is synthesized by chemistry, once you have one, if one qubit works, our idea is that you can create cheap identical small qubits. By cheap means that once you have one, you can generate as many as you want. All of them are identical because they are created by nature, and they are small. In order to, if you have ideas of putting many of them together or to scale up them in different ways. Of course, these only advantages, but there is a big problem, which is that the coupling of one single molecule to a superconducting resonator is very small. Okay, so it's a very challenging thing to generate to build a setup where you have couplings larger than kilohertz. Okay, so they are not sufficiently strong couplings to generate this strong light matter interaction between the spin qubits and the magnetic field generated in the resonator. So we have 2 ideas to improve this coupling, and I will tell you one which is the more advanced at the moment. So the first idea is by lithography build nanoconstrictions. The idea is that we are going to make a nanoconstriction in the central line of the resonator. And in this way, we test now that the field is locally enhanced inside the constriction, okay? So this is a first demonstration of some years ago. This first of all, we did some numerical simulations, and depending on the width of the constriction in the center, the intensity of the field, which are marked here in these lines, is enhanced, okay? It's only enhanced in the constriction, but it's enhanced. Theoretically, you can imagine you can have this rule of thumb where the magnetic field is enhanced 1 over the width of the constriction. This is a magnetic force microscopy in order to test that in fact the magnetic field was increased, And here you can see that the contrast and the image is larger in the constriction. So it was a first demonstration that by doing constriction, we can enhance locally the magnetic field. So this was also theoretical calculations with several molecules as a function of the width of the constriction in the center. And we see that with some species, at least theoretically, it was possible to reach this strong coupling with a single molecule. Okay? This was just theoretical plus first demonstration in resonators without the samples. Okay? The next thing is how to deposit or how to put the molecules inside the constrictions, okay? If it is possible technically or not. By this, we use nanotechnology techniques like with an atomic force microscopy. With this thing, we can deposit the molecules inside the constriction. This is a photograph of a constriction here, and in red, it means the density of molecules that that are put in the constriction. So with a big precision, these people in Zaragoza can put here the molecules inside the constriction. Okay? And with this, with just putting molecules, I repeat, they are not single molecules yet, it's just an ensembles, but with these ensembles, we can extract the single molecule coupling to the magnetic field as a function of the width of the constriction. These points are three experimental results with three samples, and the lines are theoretical calculations. And you can see there is a, maybe there's bad news, but we understand why if we decrease so much the width of the constriction, this does not follow this straight line. It's because, as I said, we are working with ensembles, so not all the molecules are at the optimal point. So you are looking at some kind of average coupling. So if we were able to work with a single molecule and put in the optimal point, we will follow this straight line here. So the point is that so far, theoretical predictions much are in agreement with our first experiments, and I remind you that our theoretical calculations predict that we can do strong coupling with some species of molecules at sufficiently small widths. And another advantage of using these molecules is that at a single site, we can put more than one molecule. This can be done by chemistry. Chemist people can do a rise of molecules that each one could be used as a spin qubit. And more importantly, one of these molecules are different and respond differently to a local magnetic field. So they can be distinguishable one from the other. Okay? So this is the future. So the question is, what can we do? What kind of experiments we can do, even if we cannot reach this strong coupling limit with a single molecule? So if we think in ensembles, or in many atoms, or many molecules coupled to the electromagnetic field, the basic stuff or the basic phenomena is superradiance. Okay, in superradiance, you have, since decay, you have n identical and uncoupled atoms, and these atoms are coupled to the electromagnetic field. And what light does is to break down this degeneracy between these identical atoms, creating these polaritonic states. And the most and the nice thing is that this is because it's called superradiance. These polaritonic states emit and absorb coherently light enhanced by the square root of n. Okay. In another word, these polaritonic states are square root of n enhanced coupling to the electromagnetic field. So we can use this enhancement to see coupling between the molecules and the superconducting resonator. So this was done by other groups working with spin ensembles, and I will tell you a new thing that we did quite recently in Zaragoza. So we are going to work not with resonators, but with open lines, so propagating photons. So we are going to have a continuous set of modes, electromagnetic modes in one dimension. This in one dimension, it's good because it enhances the coupling to the molecules, the electromagnetic field. We are going to work with spin 1/2 molecules, which are called DPPH. This is a molecule which are tested as a test molecules in EPR, so are well known. And this is the Hamiltonian. This is the Dicke Hamiltonian, and this is the coupling between each molecule and the propagating photons traveling through this transmission line. And this is a sample, and we're going to use the sample in a powder form, not in a crystal form, but in a powder form. And I will justify why we use this powder form for the spins. Sorry. Superradiance can be observed in a transmission experiment. If you think in that you have this transmission line and you put several molecules one after the other and you compute the transmission and the reflection, you do the equations, then you get this for the transfer matrix, and the total transmission can be written in this way. Okay, and you see already here that the coupling or the width of the transmission is the sum of the g of a square root. To the square. So this is the square root of n enhancement in the coupling that I told you before. This was already discussed by Andreas Wollraff group with two qubits. So now we are going to do this with ensembles of macroscopic number of molecules, this superradiance stuff. So this superradiance stuff it can be also be useful in a practical way, because you can do broadband spectroscopy. You don't have a resonator, so you have an open line. So in principle, you have a continuous set of frequencies. Here is an experiment in 10 gigahertz regime, where we observe the transmission of these 1/2 spins as a function of the applied field. So these spins are very simple. So the splitting of the spins are proportional to the magnetic field applied, and this follows this straight line. Okay, and you see that this in this range of frequency, the experimental predictions agrees with simple theory without fitting parameters. Okay, these oscillations, which are very nasty here, and you can also hear, is probably because our experimental facilities, that we have a lot of reflections in the ends of the transmission line that we are now trying to improve by buying new microwave equipment. But everything is understood quite well. So essentially, even if we cannot reach this strong coupling, this is a first application, with these superconducting resonators and with samples, we can use this broadband spectroscopy to measure the spectrum of more complicated molecules put in the sample. So we work with DPPH, and this is the atomic positions when you go to the X-ray data. I only put here the spins positions, okay? They are free radicals, so they are complicated molecules, but I just put the position of where the spin are, okay, the spin 1/2. You see that this is a 3D, but in one direction, the spins are more packaged than in the other direction, okay? So essentially, you have, in the magnetic language, you have two Curie temperatures. The first Curie temperature, which is the higher, is the when the magnetics are ordered in this direction, and the other Curie temperature is when the order or the molecules start to observe, to feel the molecules in this plane, in the plane of the slide, okay? So we have a structure between 1D and 2D. The model of these molecules is the Heisenberg model. And what is important for us is slightly anisotropic. Okay? It's not isotropic Heisenberg model, but it's slightly anisotropic, and it's between 1D or 2D. So it's kind of ladder structure. So you have a larger coupling in one direction than in the other, just because the atoms are located in this way. These are more far away than in this direction. Okay. So we did some very simple mean field calculation, and if you mean field calculation for I forgot to say that these are antiferromagnetic molecules. So we plot here the antiferromagnetic mean field phase diagram. So at sufficiently high temperature or sufficiently high applied magnetic field, so the spins are in the paramagnetic region. So the spins don't feel the magnetic correlation between them. You can treat them molecules as independent spins, okay? And this regime was, in fact, the regime where we can get these plots where the spins are independent and everything can be understood with a simple decay superradiance theory. If we decrease the temperature, then the magnetic correlations, the spins start to feel the magnetic correlations, and then at the beginning you have the spin flop, so there are some angle between the spins, okay, in the molecules, because the spins tend to be anti-parallel because they are anti-ferromagnets, and if you decrease the applied magnetic field, then you enter in the active anti-ferromagnetic phase where the spins are completely anti-parallel. Here, for what follows, it's also important that this transition between the spin flop and the antiferromagnetic phase depends on the anisotropy. I told you that the Heisenberg model of this DPPH is anisotropic. Okay, so anisotropy plays a role in considering this transition here between the spin flop and the antiferromagnetic phase. It's very simple textbook example of mean field theory. This is a cartoon of what happens. So for temperature larger than this nil temperature or this order temperature, so all the spins in each in the molecule are in the paramagnetic phase, so are parallel to the applied magnetic field. Here I put these islands are nothing but the grains. I told you that we are using grains as a powder sample. It's not crystal, but it's a powder sample. So each of these islands are grains of the material. If we decrease the temperature, okay, below this order temperature, since each grain is orientated randomly, each grain is going to have a different anisotropy axis, okay? In other words, the angle between the anisotropy axis and the applied magnetic field is going to be different. It's going to be randomly orientated at each grain, okay? So I try to put this where the spins, the difference, the angle between the spins depends on each grain, depends on the angle between the applied magnetic field and the anisotropy axis in each grain. So in this cartoon says that here, above the nil temperature, the spins are like uncoupled, so we are in the decay conditions, where you are equal atoms, uncoupled atoms, okay? So everything is well understood. But here, each grain, so this degeneracy is lifted. So each grain feels the electromagnetic field in a different way. So we cannot treat this material as an independent spins, but the spins have already magnetic correlations which can compete with the light induced correlations to generate this super radiant mode. So this is a transmission experiment done as a function of temperature. These are experimental data. Okay. Have some applied magnetic field. So we are at high temperatures. We just have this Lorentzian line shape, which can be understood with a simple theory that I showed you before. Okay. I forgot to say that before putting in the resonator, we characterize the magnetically the molecules, and we have this second temperature of order temperature is 0.65 Kelvin. So with this number, we can fix our mean field, we can fix the mean field hopping, and there is only one fitting parameter, which is the anisotropy. The rest is fixed by this 0.65 Kelvin and the applied field. So I forgot to say that for the theory I will show you before, later, there's only one fitting parameter. Okay. So high temperature, paramagnetic phase, spins, the spins are uncoupled, very simple. If we decrease the temperature, then it seems that the superradiance or this simple Lorentzian line shape is borrowed up, okay? What's happened here? Okay. Well, to understand this, we combine this mean field for the molecules coupled to this resonator with this variational method to find the free energy, and we do the numerics, sorry, the dynamics for the spin wave, for the k equal to zero spin wave. Our samples are very small comparable to the wavelength of the photons. Okay, this is the most simple thing you can do. If you do this, at the end, the mean field, you just need to compute the average angles between the spins in the antiferromagnet, and you have the applied magnetic field and the angle that the anisotropy the angle between the anisotropy axis and the applied magnetic field. Okay, so this is a parameter, as I told you, that in the powder is randomly orientated. Okay, so if you do these numerical simulations in the magnetic molecules, you find this. You need to go to Kittel in the 50s, where they compute the antiferromagnetic resonance, which is the resonance that responds these antiferromagnets. Okay, you can use linear response theory, and in the paramagnetic region, all the spins, all the grains are the same. So this is the resonance frequency which matches the magnetic field applied to the sample. But as soon as you arrive to this Curie temperature, each angle responds to a different frequency. Okay, so you have a broadening on the frequency response depending on this C angle here. These are theoretical calculations, then you put this mean field theory, you put in this light matter coupling Hamiltonian, and you can compute the spectrum of the transmission what you expect. Here are two things. First of all, we are using a mean field. So the mean field predicts sharper transition. So in fact, in the experiment, there is no phase transition, because I told you this is you should understand this material as something between 2D and 1D, and the Heisenberg in 2D is not critical. So there's not phase transition, so everything is smoother. But despite the fact this sharper transition here with mean field, the mean field explains the physics, and the physics is what I just told you before. If we go in a little bit more detail, if we plot the visibility in the transmission, this is the dots are experimental points, and the solid lines are mean field theory. We see that far away from the transition point, mean field and experiment matches quite well, so we can understand everything. And of course, mean field predicts a sharper transition. And what we observe is that what we will have in the visibility that will grow from around here, it decreases in the transition. So essentially, what we are suppressing is super radiance below this nil temperature, because of the magnetic correlation between the molecules. We also can understand the width of the transmission with the same numerical calculations. Here, since we are here in a conference of quantum computing and quantum simulation, this is a classical calculation, very simple, but in order to simulate this material, it's very hard, because we need to compute this in 2D. So maybe this kind of experiments is also a motivation for doing quantum computers or quantum simulation of these materials to really simulate what happens in these materials. It's a pity, but I'm the theoretician who did it, not a good one, because I just did the mean field stuff. But these two guys was really the ones who did the experiments. Mark is now in Delft. Fernando is in Zaragoza. We also have help from Johannes Mayer in Vienne, who collaborate in doing these resonators, and people in chemistry who help us with the molecules and trying to investigate what are the best molecules to do these things. Okay, and also I acknowledge these funds. So just I led you these conclusions. So we have the challenge to test if we can substitute superconducting circuit by magnetic molecules. Before reaching this challenge, we can do some interesting many body physics with these things. We can extract, for example, magnetic correlations or this transition, these magnetic materials, by looking at the transmission and reflection of these open lines in this broadband spectroscopy. Also with chemistry, it is possible to arrange these molecules in 1D or 2D arrays of spins, and these arrays can be place on top of the superconducting resonators in order to observe the physics happening in this low-dimensional spin arrays. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thanks for the interesting talk. So you're the theoretician. I'm not sure if I should ask you the question, but how many photons do you have compared to the number of spins on your transmission line, or the number of molecules?
Yeah, there are, so we are using linear response theory, so there are much less photons than the spins now in the experiments.
And the same for the experimental data you presented?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So, I mean, the calculations we are not improving, they are improving the experimental capabilities, but with these experiments, in fact, was with some power, but we have a lot of molecules with a big ensembles. But the calculations you can do is single photon transmission. So, in principle, but it's linear response, so there's no saturated sample. It's not saturated sample.
So maybe I can ask you a question. So you were throwing this question in the beginning that maybe you can replace superconducting qubits by molecules. You didn't seem to give us a conclusion. Maybe you can elaborate on that.
So if we can.
Yeah, in the beginning you said that you said maybe we can substitute superconducting qubits with molecules. So what can you say now after this talk?
Well, I mean, it's a... Yeah, we need to do something, right? To justify. There are experts on magnetic. I'm not saying that these are better than superconducting circuits. It's just we are exploring other possibilities, and they have advantage as any architect. So everyone who has made an architecture, he emphasized the advantage. But here the main drawback is the coupling, which is very small because it's with a single molecule. But in principle, it's possible to. I mean, our first objective is to demonstrate experimentally a strong coupling with a single molecule at the single photon limit. And we have this strategy, we have another one. And in principle, our theoretical calculations say that this is possible. And so far, the experiments follow the experimental, so the theoretical predictions.
Your talk. I have a question about the beginning of your talk. Maybe it's a little bit naive. You say that in every construction you can deposit actually more than one molecule, so you can have more than one. I don't know how it works. More than one qubit. Yeah, exactly. So I was wondering how it works in this case, the transmission of the information. It works that first is moved inside of one chain and then from the tip to the closest neighborhood, or it can also work kind of a two-dimensional lattice. Like, for example, the first molecule in the first constraint can interact with this first molecule in the second one and so on.
Yeah, I borrowed sign. Okay, thank you for the question. The idea is that, for example, this is a five qubit setup in each place, because this was thinking for a proposal to do an algorithm here. So the idea is that each molecule of this is strongly coupled. This is a cartoon for the constriction. Okay, so each of this molecule, which here is a spins labeled as an arrows, are strongly coupled to the resonator. So each molecule is coupled, this one is coupled to this one, but also this one is coupled to the other one via the transmission line, okay, or the resonator. Yeah. And more importantly, these molecules are you can by chemistry, by modifying the environment of the spin, you can make them distinguishable from external magnetic field. So you can you can select these molecules and interaction all to all in this direction. Yeah, 1 and 5 here.
Thank the speaker again.